Seniors and friends, good evening. We welcome you to the Lex Ponder e-lecture series 2020, hosted by the NKM Law Chambers. As we are all in the midst of the lockdown and we are keeping ourselves occupied, it's a great opportunity to listen to webinars and e-lectures, which we've been hearing for the last several weeks, conducted by several law firms and law offices. Following suit, I take this opportunity to begin the e-lecture series. And in the first place, I would place my heartfelt thanks to Mr. Siddharth Dave, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India, who has been very kind enough to agree to address the first lecture. Mr. Siddharth Dave is a Senior Advocate who was designated in 2019, a 1997 graduate from the National Law School of India University in Bangalore. He is one among the brightest and most sought after young Senior Advocates in the Supreme Court. And in fact, on a personal note, I have briefed him in a couple of matters and we have had good success. So I think the success has just converted into the meeting. Hopefully this is just the beginning of many more meetings that Mr. Dave would address. And he's an expert in criminal law, has a very strong passion for the subject. And that is the reason we have chosen a very important contemporary and relevant topic of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act and the National Investigation Agency with specific reference, which for the next 50 minutes to 1 hour, we will have Mr. Dave speaking on. And I would like to thank all participants for your support. And we hope that this endeavor keeps getting bigger. Now the floor is left open to Sri Dave, who will take it up from now. So that's up, please. You can begin, sir.
Thank you, Naveen. And I'm privileged to address a gathering of lawyers mostly, and maybe other people, on a subject.
So several law students have also participated.
Yeah, so law students who will probably, because this topic is a very important topic, and as the lecture sort of unfolds, you will realize that where this act, this UAPA Act, what it was meant for and where it has reached now, and the amount the government is going to use this act for various purposes is only going to increase. So on that note, I want to thank you, Naveen, because this topic, though most webinars, etc., are held on commercial topics and not much on criminal law, this yes. one is an important topic. And therefore, I would like again to extend thanks to you. And yes, thank you for the compliment about being the brightest, etc., that you said. And it was a privilege working with you. So without much ado, I'd like to start, because it's quite an extensive topic. And it's difficult sort of to narrow it down to any a particular topic in the act, either in UAP or NIA, though NIA is a very small act. But with your permission, I'd like to begin with this lecture.
Yes, sir, please.
So the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act is of 1967. And the sort of genesis of the act came about 16 years after we obtained our independence. And the immediate cause for having an act like the Unlawful Activities, or UAP as I'll refer to it during the course of this lecture, was probably the India-China War of 1962. Soon after the India-China War, there were, and particularly the troubles that were taking place in Northeast India, there was a council that was set up by the government, which was known as the National Integration Council. And that council appointed a committee on national integration and regionalism. And the recommendations of the committee were given in about 1963. Two things, primary things, flowed from that committee's recommendation. One was something as big as a constitution amendment, which was the 16th constitutional amendment that took place. And second was, some years later, the passing of the UAPA. Now, the primary purpose of this council, National Integration Council, as from the wordings of the council itself, was that there was a move to control the activities within India that were leading to a sort of what was felt by the powers or the government at that time into disintegration of India. So after 62, there were various voices, or even prior to the India-China war, about how certain areas in India were not or were asking for some sort of a secession from India and wanted to align themselves with other powers. Now, we are not talking about Jammu and Kashmir in this. It was primarily meant for Northeast and some other states. So the committee held many deliberations, and the first suggestion that the committee gave was to amend Article 19 of the Constitution. Now, as you all very well know, Article 19 provides for various rights, and those rights are in the form of freedom of speech and expression, assembly peaceably without arms, and to form association and to move within India, etc. There are about six of them, property having been deleted. So it suggested, even though there had been an amendment in 1951 as far as the restrictions was concerned, and the amendment was quite specific, it suggested that in Article 19, 2, 3, and 4, which correspondingly deal with Article 19, 1A, freedom of speech and expression, Article 19, 1B, to assemble peaceably without arms, and Article 19, 1C, to form associations, it suggested in Articles 19, 2, 3, and 4, that the words for reasonable restrictions, the words sovereignty and integrity of India be added. Now, it was for the first time that the words sovereignty and integrity of India came to be added in as far as the protection or sovereignty of India is concerned, to maintain its sovereignty and, more importantly, integrity. Now, integrity assumed importance because, like I said, there were various moves to secede from India, and therefore the council suggested that laws that are made which restrict freedom of speech or freedom of association or freedom to assemble peaceably without arms be not be allowed to be challenged or be supported by the fact that they are in the interest of the sovereignty and integrity of India. So the laws that the parliament decided to come out was, and of course this being amendment to the constitution, the parliament also had to locate within its powers in the list in 7th schedule under which law would it be legislating under. So first what the parliament did was to amend 19, 2, 3 and 4 and introduce the words, the sovereignty and integrity of India, that were in addition to public order, interests, law imposing in the interest, reasonable restrictions, etc. So with this, I mean, that was not the only amendment in the 16th. It also amended various oaths that were taken by minister, by MPs, MLAs, etc., to include that you shall uphold the in sovereignty and integrity of India apart from the constitution. So the main thrust was to impose, to have the protection of sovereignty and integrity of India. Now, as that remains, that is the for the constitutional challenge of an act. But there was no other provision that existed except for the Indian Penal Code and the what was contained in sedesh, for incitement, sedition, etc. There was no specific legislation that was dealing with this subject. So after much deliberation in about 4 years, in 1967, the parliament enacted the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Now this act was a direct product, as I said, for the maintenance of integrity of India. And at the time that it was enacted, it was not so complicated. It was a fairly simple act. And if you pick up the Bear Act now, it has gone into various aspects, having many sections, subsections being added to it by various amendments, to which I will come to subsequently. And the primary object was twofold in the Act. One was session, which was that anyone advocating or agreeing that a part of territory of India belonged to some other country, that is under 2B, and under 2D was secession, that anyone who advocated the assertion or the claim that any part of India would not be within the territory of India. At the time in 67, these two were the main ingredients that the act was concerned with, cession and secession. That means if a person agreed, suppose China laid a claim to a particular territory anywhere in India, or another country laid a claim to any part, and one I as an individual or an organization agreed to that claim, that would be covered by 2B, or I myself advocated the secession of any part of a state, etc., from India, that would be covered under 2D, secession. And it declared that for the first time, quite surprisingly, that any person who, or an association of persons who advocated either secession or cession, would be, that act would be made punishable. That particular act of secession would be made punishable. And it also gave powers to central government to declare an association of person as unlawful. Now, this was possibly the first time that such a power was vested to say that primarily the control was to control political parties as far as their demands for ceding away from the territory of India was concerned, and therefore it was a direct violation of the integrity of India. Now, anecdotally, it is said, and to my friends in Chennai and in Tamil Nadu, the immediate cause, one of the cause was of DMK at that particular time not being happy with being aligned with India, and there was a worry at the central government level that the political organization in some states may advocate the secession of territories of from India. So therefore, the act made, apart from making it punishable, it also provided the power to vest with the central government to declare a particular association as unlawful under Section 3. But it wasn't a power that was vested entirely with the central government. It did set up under Section 4 a tribunal to be manned by a High Court judge who would adjudicate the correctness of that decision. Now, all this is assuming importance now, and I'm jumping many years hence. In 2019 amendment, there is the power to declare a person as a terrorist, which we will come to later. But the origins are from Section 3, that the central government would declare a particular association as unlawful because that association indulged in unlawful activities. Those unlawful activities were primarily secession and secession from India. So the tribunal under 4 would adjudicate, and the Supreme Court in 1995 said this is not like the advisory board in as an advice-based board, but under preventive detention, but it's adjudicatory, it's a process is judicial, and the decision of the tribunal is binding upon the central government. So if there is a particular organization which is declared as unlawful, and the High Court judge or the tribunal that is so constituted under UAPA finds that no, upon the material that it has gone into, that it is not an unlawful organization, or there exists no material to come to declare it as an unlawful organization. So it would strike that down, and that is binding upon the government, of course, subject to challenge that they may have in the Supreme Court. It also then provided for in Chapter 3 in a very simple form of for offenses and penalties for being members of an unlawful association. So it provided for penalties in the nature if you were a member of an association which was unlawful because it was advocating one of those two causes, that it was, you would be punished by because you were a member. And that punishment is up for about 2 years. In This is in section 10. Now keep various timelines in mind, because this act has undergone a sort of an overhaul, as I said at the beginning. There are various periods when it goes through dramatic and drastic amendments. And one of those amendments is in 2004 that takes place. Also keep in the at the backdrop two other acts which were passed by the parliament. One was TADA in 1987 and the other was FOTA in 2002. Now TADA lapsed about in 97. It had a run for about 10 years and it lapsed then. And FOTA had a run for 2 years because both were egregious in their violation of basic rights that a person has under the Code of Criminal Procedure and as well as under the Constitution. And there were violations at a large scale, targeting minorities, targeting various people. And so they were. But what was not noticed is that the government of the day, which was Congress in 2004, decided was strictly against FOTA as an act, but and did not continue with it when it came to power in May 2004. When it did not agree to continue that, it needed something else to fall back upon, because the parliament attack case had taken place and terrorism had again surfaced a word. Now, words like terrorism, etc., are all, according to me, any offense that these special laws tend to make are already well covered by the Indian Penal Code, and they do not require any further creation of new offenses, because they are at best just regurgitating what is contained in the Indian Penal Code. But anyway, while allowing FOTA to lapse, the central government then decided to incorporate many provisions that it had in 2004 and 2008 into the UAPA. Now, UAPA's constitutional validity has never been challenged. TADA was challenged and it was upheld in Kartar Singh, and as was FOTA. But UAPA, surprisingly, has never been challenged, because in 67, or as the passage went, they thought that it was on legislative competence, primarily on legislative competence. It was not challenged, but they possibly thought that because of it was enacted for the purposes under the Entry of Defense of India. So it would be, but anyway, be that as it may, there's always lies the challenge. What it did do in 2004 was it amended Section 10 and introduced a more stringent and a broader definition for persons who are having doing unlawful activities. And it said that if a person is a member of an unlawful association and it aids and promotes the objects of the association and possesses any firearm, explosives, or it by being a member of that organization commits certain acts by which there is a loss of human life, then the offense, if it has resulted in loss of human life, would be punishable with death or life. And in other cases where it is not, no death is caused, it would be punished with minimum of 5 years and to life. So that very narrow section that was there in Section 10 in the original UAPA was broadened vastly in 2004 to include by association, doing certain acts, abetting or promoting the objects of that association, which in turn may lead to a loss of human life or otherwise injuries on persons. So you would be punished under Section 10B now with these stringent death or life or minimum of 5 years. As far as unlawful activity was concerned of an individual, that was in Section 13. And by that Section 13, if you incited or promoted or advocate unlawful activity, it would be punished under 7 years. Now, please bear in mind, unlawful activity is the activity that is defined that I just stated at the beginning about secession and session. And 10 was made more stringent, that merely by being member of an unlawful association and those acts being committed which result in loss of human life, stringent punishments are there. As far as punishments on unlawful activities are concerned, then they were made punishable by a period of 7 years. Now, all the offenses under the Act are cognizable. Now comes another amendment in 2004, by which it introduces, they all introduce something known as terrorist activities. Now, terrorist activities throws open the entire Pandora's box again with the repeal of TADA, with the repeal of POTA, by introducing and bringing it into UAPA. And the definitions are pretty broad. They are not narrow or restricted and cover most, it defined most definitions of terrorism, which surprisingly under, they introduced, they amended the definition section under 2K by defining a terrorist act, which would have the same meaning as section 15 of UAPA, which had brought this in. Now, every time these were amended in 2008, 13 and 19, and further strengthened. And by strengthening, I mean, you are strengthening the law as far as this is concerned, but you, at the same time, the civil liberties of a person are being deprived. So by strengthening is in the favor of the government, but as far as a citizen or an individual is concerned, it is denuding the rights that a citizen has under the Constitution and under the various acts. Now, therefore, why I started off with a little history becomes important, because the legislative competence of enacting this particular act was in 1967 based on the Integration Council of 63, only for session and secession. But now it is being expanded in 2004, 8, 13 and 19 to include terrorists that would ordinarily not fall under this. So what it does, what happens now is that as far as the UAPA is concerned, there are certain terrorist offenses that are taking place in 2004, flowing from 2002 of Parliament attack, and 2008 as a direct result of the Mumbai attacks that took place. And so therefore, that gives a handle to the government of the day to strengthen these acts under the garb that, listen, our integrity, the integrity of India is threatened by the these terrorist organizations, and we need a law to deal with it. Now, the interestingly, even in the amendment that takes place of Chapter 4 of the Act under UAPA, amends even the laws, the long cause title, which now includes the words "and dealing with terrorist activities and unlawful activities." So no longer is it now restricted, the act is restricted to unlawful activities, which are dependent on strictly of cession and secession of territories of India. It is now whole and solely also for terrorist activities and terrorist organizations, as we will come to as we proceed with it. So terrorist activities are in section 15, as I said, and terrorist organizations are in chapter 6. Which are organizations like who will be declared by the central government to be included in the first schedule of the act itself. Now, 15 was very is very wide, and it imports ingredients like anyone who has an intent to threaten or threaten the integrity, unity, economic security, sovereignty, or to strike terror, or any section, or in any foreign country, is covered by Section 15. So if an Indian goes to any other country and is threatening the sovereignty or integrity of that particular country, then it would be covered by Section 15. Now, that is not the only thing, because it goes on to proceed that this threatening has to be done by the basis of bombs or dynamites or explosives or poisonous noxious gases, according pursuant to which the death or injuries is caused, loss or damage or destruction of properties. And interestingly, in 315A, Roman 3, disruption of supplies of any essential service of life community of India. And then it even goes on to have monetary stability of India, overawing the government by any by criminal force and kidnapping and detaining or killing anyone of a government servant commits a terrorist act. So the definition of a terrorist act is so vast and so broad that any person committing any kind of offense, at least for the person for the purposes of being charge-sheeted, whether he's ultimately convicted or not is a different question. For the purposes, suppose a person is protesting on the street, or that persons are protesting on the streets, and there is a dharna, and they say that, and it continues for some time, and they can easily, the government of the day can easily bring that under that you are threatening the you are disrupting the supplies or essential of or services which are essential to life. This is a threat to the integrity or security. Now all these words like integrity, security, etc. are not defined anywhere. They are just used and they have to have the normal colloquial meaning that has to be given. What is meant by the integrity, sovereignty, etc. of India is concerned. So 15 became was a major introduction for the purposes of UAPA. Now UAPA, then it went on to provide for various punishments for terrorist acts, etc., which I'm not getting into the specifics. It also provided for offenses by companies. So you have unlawful associations, you have companies, you have individuals. So everyone possible that can be covered by any organization in every sense of the word that can be covered, because person, companies and associations are covered. And trusts and societies are also covered. So they covered every aspect of it and they provided for punishment. It also provided for forfeiture, etc., of the money that is concerned. What then it did was to provide for terrorist organization under Section 35, and it gave the power to the central government to notify in the Gazette that any organization you put in the first schedule will be considered as a terrorist organization, and it will exercise the power, and it also gave it the power to denotify it for the terrorist organization. Now, for the terrorist organizations to be put there, it provided for a review committee. Now, it already had a committee in Section 3. It could have very well provided it in Section 3, but it provided under 37 for a review committee. And it said that the review committee will have a chairperson, it will consider, or which will consider, consist of the High Court. And if one was to contrast Section 3 and one was to contrast Section 37, there is a big gap that exists between the powers, etc., of Section 3. That means for an unlawful activity or unlawful association, there is more powers that are vested in the advisory body rather than what is contained in Section 37 for the terrorist organization. And you are, by being a member of the terrorist organization, you are, there is an offense that one commits, and all these aspects were brought in by this. Now, relating to the present topic, we are more concerned with chapter 7, because that's miscellaneous, and these were also all amended, and it provided for who is competent to investigate offenses which are under 4 and 6. Now, 4 and 6 specifically are terrorist activities and terrorist organizations. So as far as terrorist activities and terrorist organizations are concerned, Section 43 provided a certain rank of officers to be able to investigate. So for under the Delhi Special Police Establishment, it provided for the rank of a DSP, Deputy Superintendent of Police, or of an equivalent rank. In metropolitan cities like Delhi or Mumbai or Chennai, etc., it provided for Assistant Commissioner of Police rank. And for any other cases which is not falling under A or B, it provided again for a DSP rank. Not that it really makes a difference as to who is investigating, because the our experience from TADA and POTA, especially POTA, where DSP was to record confessions, have shown that these investigations are as good or as bad as that being considered by being conducted by an inspector at the rank of an inspector who actually is on the ground. The DSP is only the supervising body. Now, the important modification which came was in 43D, as far as investigation is concerned. Originally, it didn't exist, but now it modified the Parliament modified the Act as far as Section 167 of the Code of Criminal Procedure was concerned. Now, as all my friends would know, 167 is an invaluable right that exists, vests in a person who has been arrested to be released on bail, which is known as default bail, if a charge sheet or in the final report is not filed by the police within the time that is prescribed, above 7 years, etc., for 90 days, and below that is 60 days. So therefore, that right. Now, the Parliament chose to amend under the UAPA that period of detention from 90 days maximum, that is 3 months, to make it to 180 days, that is 6 months. So a person can be detained under for offences under UAPA for a maximum period of 180 days as far as the without a charge sheet being filed. Now, this is an egregious violation of a person's right, and it only amends 167 in a very sort of a casual manner to say that the words that the reference to 15, 90 and 60 days wherever they occur may be read as 180 days. So this 180 day is, of course, by the court, if it is satisfied on the report of a public prosecutor that the detention of the accused is required for about 90 days. Now, we all know, our lawyer friends will know about how the working of the court system, that as far as remands are concerned. Now, this act, now the reason why I was laboring on this is, and with special reference to NIA, this act does not have any special court in it. So this, the court that is referred to in this act is defined and was amended in 2008, and it does not provide for any special court. And the reason for special court becomes important when I'll deal with the NIA aspect of it, that if you don't have a special court, which is the court which can grant, and it is not being investigated by NIA, which is the court that can grant this extended custody of an accused person. Now, of course, it's a violation of the ordinary code of criminal procedure, the proviso of under 167, and an egregious violation for 6 months. So does a magistrate who is otherwise who grants remands, etc., would be in a position to provide for send an accused person or remand him for a further period of 180 days, or does it have to be a court which is higher than a magistrate's court? Now, this became interesting because under Section 2D of the Act, and this is to all the lawyer friends who are hearing this, and whenever the case comes, because various cases of this nature will come to them. Now, the definition of the court under 2D was a court means a criminal court having jurisdiction under the court to try offences under this Act, and includes a special court constituted under 11 or 21, it should be 22, but it should be 21, of the National Investigation Agency. Now, NIA has a special court that exists, which is manned by a special judge or an additional sessions judge. It has to be a sessions or an additional sessions. UAPA, as I said, does not have it. So if it is a UAPA which is being investigated by the local police at the time when they are doing it, and they ask for, and they are investigating an offense under this Act, and they want custody of the person for an extended period, they will apply to the magistrate. The magistrate will remand the person for a further period of 90 days upon the public prosecutor making out a case that exists. Now, the interesting bit is that the definition of uses the word court means a criminal court having jurisdiction under the court to try offences. Now, we are all aware that for trial of offences, under the code, under the penal code, every section is listed, and it also provides under the schedule as to who or who is to try, whether magistrate or a session judge is to try, it lists up. But as far as special laws are concerned, that is the second part of the schedule, and that only says that it will be depending upon the punishment. Now, if it is more than 7 years, as far as the special acts are concerned, then it would be the offenses under two of the schedule would be, if it is death, imprisonment, or life, or more than 7 years, then court of session. If punishable with imprisonment for 3 but not 7, it will be the magistrate. Now, if it is the court of session which is to try, because it is upwards of 7, then can the remand under 167 or the extended remand under 167 be done only by a court of session, because that is the court which will try the offense. Then the magistrate's powers go out, because it's an extended remand. The word used is the court under this 43D. The word simply used is court. And the court with the dread with the definition would necessarily mean the court which is to try the offense. So in a way, as far as interpretation is concerned, and this is the lacuna in the law that exists at the time, for the present time, that after completion of that 90 days, if there is a further remand of 90 days that has to be made, it has to be by a court which is competent to try the case as noted in section 2D. And that would necessarily have to be, if it is punishable with above 7 years, have to be by a special, by a sessions court or an additional sessions judge that exists. So this is an important facet which one may keep in mind. It also shows the manner in which such stringent criminal laws are drafted, and in such a casual way, it could have very well provided that it be done by a sessions judge rather than a magistrate who is otherwise passing orders of remand, etc. Now, apart from that, it also provides for presumption as to offenses, which is, in my opinion, absolutely horrible for to provide under 43E for presumption that there will be that the prosecution would presume, unless the contrary is shown by the accused, that accused has committed the offense, for such violations and for such acts which are punishable by death or by life. And this also assumes importance, because these were the very criticism that was there against Tada and Pota, and those are the very what the parties fought against and what civil society fought against has been incorporated under 43E as far as presumption of offenses is concerned. And then we have the cognizance. The cognizance has to be by previous sanction. And it also deals in 46 is of importance. The it deals with evidence collected through interception and communication. Interception of communication, and it says notwithstanding anything by the Indian Evidence Act or other laws, that you will not, the interception shall not be admissible unless, and there's a proviso, the accused has been given a copy of these interceptions 10 days before the trial or hearing or proceedings. So that means 10 days before the trial or proceedings means through the charge sheet, through the till the trial is, the evidence is to be introduced, the accused will be kept in the dark. These copies will not be made available to him. And only 10 days before, the judge will say, yes, these are 10 days, prosecution wishes to adduce it in the trial or hearing, and therefore I'm allowing it. You, here is the copy. So under 207, the transmission that is to be given, all the documents, it will not, as far as the intercepted communication is concerned, will not be given, and will be given only 10 days. And then it goes on, it also has a power under 51 to impound passports and arms license of persons who were charged. Now that takes care as far as the UAPA is concerned. Now what happens in 2008, especially after the Mumbai bomb blast cases, is that the parliament decides to constitute a investigating agency, a a special investigating agency. What was the reason? I really don't know why they did it. They already had CBI with them. They decided to constitute a national investigating agency. Now, this National Investigation NIA in 2008 is an agency which is under the central government. It constitutes of people from the police force. That is, as far as its constitution is concerned, in Section 3 and Section 4 onwards, that is the constitution of the NIA. But there is a restriction. The NIA cannot investigate each and every offense, but can only investigate those offenses which are there in the schedule to the act. Now, as per the last Bear Act that of 2019, there are about 8 of these acts which are there, that is anti-hijacking, anti-atomic energy, etc. And interestingly, there is UAP. Now, you have to see it, events proceeding side by side, because UAPA, the terrorist activities have been brought in 2004, they have been strengthened in 2008, and now the parliament feels that we have to have a special investigating agency or a police force directly under the central government to investigate offences. I'm leaving aside the other ones for the time being, offences under UAPA. So not only has it gone a step ahead of TADA and POTA, which at least did not have a special investigating authority, now the parliament has, in the backdrop of the Mumbai attack, has constituted another investigative agency altogether. Whether a parliament can investigate agents, investigate offences, agencies constituted under a parliamentary act can investigate offences, because public law and order, etc., are all domains of the country. The new sides to constitute. Now, what the NIA does is that its investigation and how it comes into the picture is rather interesting, because it, like I said, it can investigate only those 8 offences and 8 acts, not offences, and offences under those 8 acts. It comes into the picture under Section 6 in Chapter 3. In a very casual way, it is brought in, if I can say. 6 says that if there is an FIR in any local authority or by a local police station, and the IO thinks or is of the opinion that one of the offences is an offence which is into the scheduled offence, then he will transmit the report to the state government. So the burden has been put on an IO that suppose there is an offence under UAPA that has been committed, or UAPA is the various, it can, or any other act for the time, because even offences under the Indian Penal Code in Chapter 6 of Indian Penal Code from 121 to 130, both of them included, have also been put under this NIA Act. So if the investigating officer feels that one of the offences that he is reporting, lodging the FIR for, is an offence which falls under one of the scheduled offences, he will then transmit a report of this to the central government. Now to the state government. Now once the state government receives this, it will then transmit the report to the central government. Now, the central government, one would think that this is the only way, but no. Now, the central government, now surprisingly in 3, and this is the play of the words, in subsection 3 of 6, it says that if once the central government has received this information from the state government or has received from any other source the information, so not necessarily that which has been transmitted by, that an offence which is covered by the schedule, the first schedule of the NIA Act has been committed, any one of the offences under any one of those acts has been committed, it will decide regarding the gravity of the offence, whether it is a fit case to be investigated by the agency or not. So not only is it the IEO sending a report to the central government and to the state government forwarding it to the central government, but even if the central government comes to know of it on its own, then it will decide whether it is worthy of investigation by NIA. If it decides that if it is a fit case for investigation by the NIA, then central government decides, then it will direct the NIA to investigate the case. Now this is subsection 4 of 6. This is against all tenets of what we are asking today and where we are about independence of investigation. NIA will investigate only those cases which the central government tells it to investigate. It cannot investigate any other case on its own or otherwise. It is directly and under total control of the central government by the fact that it can investigate only such cases which are given to it by central government after the central government has decided, having regard to the gravity of offense, etc., that it is a fit case to be investigated by the NIA. Now, mind you, this is after an FIR has already been lodged in a local police station in a state for the commission of the offense, and those are being investigated by the local police. Now, it is incumbent upon the IO to send that report to the state government and state government to the central government. And then if the central government decides to entrust it to NIA, then it's all hands off for that offense. Then NIA moves into the picture and all the documents are to be transmitted to NIA, and all other investigation by the local police, which was happening up till then, will come to a halt immediately. That is provided for in section 6. 5, subsection 5 of 6 is important because again it says that sent on a report by the state government if the central government has decided, or suo moto. So if it is suo moto, then the central government can interfere in any area or any police or any matter of law and order in any state government and provide and take over the investigation which was being investigated by the local police of that particular state. And surprisingly, in 7, instead of in 6, they provide that all hands approach the moment NIA steps in. It says that to remove the doubts, that till the agency takes it over, the local police will continue to investigate. It is, the section is bizarre as far as construction is concerned, because once you have taken over, or there is a notification to that effect by the central government entrusting the investigation to the NIA, where is the question for the local police to start to continue investigating if the NIA and he has transmitted the documents and to the agency to continue with investigation? No, but it still again puts a burden on the local police to say that till it takes over the investigation, takes up the investigation is the word, it shall be the duty of the officer in charge of the police to continue the investigation. If the police officer does not have, the local police officer does not have the papers, there is a notification, he has transmitted it, what is he going to investigate? We don't know, but all responsibilities are on the state local officers. And as far as NIA is concerned, it will come whenever it decides to have, according to the gravity and central government deciding it, to come over and take over the investigation. Then it then provides in 7 that it can transfer the investigation back to the state government for investigation and trial. So you've taken, the NIA has taken it over, but then it decides to transfer it back to the state government. Now, and then there are other sections that they can investigate the other offenses, like in prevention of corruption, etc. You have, if there are collateral offenses which are not covered by the UAPA or anti-hijacking, other offenses in IPC, NIA can investigate those as well. So all they need is one predicate offense, one predicate offense under one of these acts that are there in the first schedule. And along with it, there can be 50 other offenses which are not falling under any of those legislations which are put under the first schedule, but all under IPC or other section or other acts. Those can be investigated by the NIA by virtue of Section 8. Now, Section 11 is important because it sets up a special court by the central government. So, central government sets up a special court. That judge under in 11.7 will be a judge who will be either a session judge or an additional judge. Of course, this is all with consultation with the Chief Justice of the High Court, etc., and all those general provisions that exist. But the important point is that the special court is there under NIA and they are investigating under offenses under UAPA. So the moment NIA moves into the picture to investigate an offense under UAPA, it takes away from the local magistrate or the local court, which was there, which we read under Section 2D, and it moves into an arena of the special judge. Now, the powers and the jurisdiction of the special judge are quite serious, because in 16 it says that the special court may take cognizance of an offense without the accused being committed to it, which basically means that the special court is there from the very beginning itself, like many other legislations have. Under the Prevention of Corruption Act, you also have, which experience we have with while dealing with, many cases of prevention of corruption. It is a court from the very beginning, and it is a special court which is constituted for the purposes of NIA. Therefore, I was pointing out the dichotomy earlier that as far as a UAPA offense not being investigated by NIA, a magistrate has the power to remand a person for 180 days. But as far as NIA is concerned, it will be a special court, and that the power to remand the accused for 180 days will then vest with the special court, who will be the rank of session judge or of additional session judge. Now, the it also has its own public prosecutor, etc., to investigate the cases. Now, this act then goes on to say that, of course, provides that particular special court also to try all other offenses. Now, as we all are aware, that there is a decision of the Supreme Court and under a special law where no case of special law is made out, but there is a special court constituted. They said that still the power to try for those other offenses will continue, and the person will continue to be tried by the special court itself. So the special court here also under Section 14 will try the other offenses, whether under the offense under one of the scheduled offenses made out or not, but it will continue to try for the other offenses. Then we come to the 16 I had read to all of you, which is the procedure and powers of the court. And then 19 is trial of by special court to have precedence. Now, the trial of the special court will have precedence under NIA for an offense under UAPA. And on the other hand, you may have an offense under UAPA, which the central government, according to the gravity, has decided not to investigate by NIA, which will continue, and the person will continue languishing, because these are very serious offenses under UAPA, will continue to be languishing in jail. He will continue to subject to incarceration, and there will be no precedence of his trial, because unlike another person in his next cell block, it may be, has a case being investigated by NIA, and that person will have, his trial will have precedence, his trial will have. What I'm trying to say is that all these procedural aspects have been brought in under the NIA Act, which strictly are not concerned with the investigative power of the agency that is constituted. These are all judicial functions that are there. After the filing of charge sheet, the prosecution goes out from the hands of the investigative agency and then vests with the state. And the court's role becomes primary. Now, here, by constituting an investigative agency, I can understand that an agency is constituted and you've given it some certain powers, etc. But where was the occasion to vest all these other powers, which are more in judicial in nature than, and have nothing to do with the NIA, but only cases that have been investigated by the NIA? Now, more importantly, the Act provides, like I said about precedence, it also provides in 21 of appeals that will lie for matters that are investigated by NIA. Now, it does not stand to my reason, at least, that why a person who's being investigated by the local police under UAPA will have one particular procedure being followed when the substantive law is UAPA and the procedural law here providing for only the investigative part is different to provide for an appeal revision right being provided under section 21 to the extent that even it mandates that all appeals, etc., from the special judge will be heard by a division bench and not by a single judge. It even is changing the nature of the roster that may exist in the High Court, that you may have a revision which goes before a single judge under the NIA. If it is investigated by NIA, the roster will get changed because it's NIA and it will go before a division bench. In a lot of High Courts in Allahabad, I'm not so sure about Chennai, etc., you have revisions which are heard by single judges. Now here it is by a division bench. Even bail cases will be heard by a division bench because that is the mandate of Section 21. And then it also provides at the same time the power to the state government to constitute special courts. Now, I cannot understand why the state government would be constituting special courts except for the scheduled offenses. Now, if it is for the scheduled offenses, the amendments should have come in those acts which they are mentioned in the first schedule. Now, here to mention for the NIA investigation, those acts which are mentioned in the first schedule to have special courts to be constituted by special by state government does not stand to reason. And the transfer from one to the other, the power will lie with the Supreme Court, even intra, and with the High Court if from a sessions division. So the and the list in the schedule which is there to the Act under NIA is the atomic energy, UAPA, hijacking, civil aviation, and weapons of mass destruction, and 121 to 130, and counterfeiting of currency, so IPC. So two parts of IPCs included in that. Now, the point that really the investigation is that the NIA Act does not really provide for any better investigation in any manner. The Act is absolutely silent as far as that aspect is concerned. It has done everything as far as changing the procedure is concerned and providing for certain amendments as far as the trial and judicial functions are concerned, but it does not provide for any manner that the NIA will do a more scientific investigation, NIA will use certain agencies, NIA will be in touch with other agencies who specialize in these kind of investigations, particularly because they are such serious offenses that have been listed with it. And none of those are there in the Act which creates the National Investigation Agency. Only aspect that is covered is that there is an agency, the central government will pick and choose, and once it has chosen, it will decide to continue with it, or it can give it back to the state government. And there is a special court with a session judge or an additional session judge, and they are really there is a special court even by state government. So the NIA investigation that we have is nothing that we have to think that it is something which has fallen from the sky or is anyway superior to any other investigation. It is the local police which is recruited. It is the procedure for investigation, etc., is all the same under the CRPC. Nothing else has changed except that only pick and choose of cases which the central government wants. Now, one aspect that I did want to address since it's already 7, is the manner of invocation or misuse of UAPA that is taking place. And this is taking place for the reason of this amendment of 167, which extends the time period to 180 days. What is happening now is that a large section of protests across India that are taking place are being covered or invoked. UAPA is being invoked against the persons who are protesting in any manner. Now, we go back to 63. the protest could not be against the sovereignty or integrity of India. Now, if you're protesting against a particular legislation or against a particular policy, the government is choosing to invoke UAPA as far as and inflict UAPA on the protesters for the reason, and the simple reason is, apart from the fact that it is punishable with more stringent punishments, for the simple reason that they can keep an under trial in custody for a period of 180 days. There is no other reason, because otherwise on the 90th day, they would have had to file the charge sheet and show to the court the investigation that is done. So now to deny bail under 167, we have invoked UAPA. You can invoke UAPA on the 89th day and then come and say that we have invoked UAPA on the 89th day. Now we have a further period of 90 days that we are enabled. Here is the public prosecutor who's making out a case because our investigation is underway. So now kindly extend the custody of the person for another 90 days, and which is what is happening. So these are the various broad topics which are there under UAPA and NIA Act. I'm happy to take any questions to clear any doubts, etc. Any of the participants may have as far as this is concerned. 4-5 questions. I think we have some time, though I think I've extended my time. I'll ask Naveen what is the position and how do we proceed further from here. And any questions that anyone has, please ask and please let me know.
Sir, thank you very much for such a wonderful lecture. All of us have benefited so much. In fact, you've given the perspective that you see from the other side. I think people who have listened to it certainly have been so benefited. I leave it to the audience. Anybody who are interested in asking any question, please. I'll ask a question at last, before that anybody else. Anyone else? Varsha, please unmute everybody so that anybody who wants to ask a question, they can ask.
There is some question which is there on the chat.
Yes, sir.
Which says, from Asif Mohammed, which says that Can advocate participate in investigation by NIA?
Yes.
So, of course, it's participating in Asif's question. Advocates participating in the investigation, of course, they can't participate in the investigation because they don't have a system where advocates are required to be there, the right to consult a legal practitioner. But the accused will be represented, and that is the only limited extent to which advocates can participate in an investigation so far as representation of accused is concerned in an investigation done by the NIA.
All right, sir. Thank you, sir. Varsha, you can probably mute everyone. They can probably give the question in the chat. Varsha, please mute everyone. They can... Friends, whoever have any questions, please put it in the chat so that they can reply.
Now, there is... So there is a question from Aditya Mehta who says that the question is that, do you have any comments on the manner in which the NIA took over the investigation into the Bhima Koregaon offense in Maharashtra with specific reference to the constitutionality of the same? Now, of course, the Bhima Koregaon case is a particularly difficult topic to deal with because... And the manner in which it is done is, according to me, and nothing but an abuse of process of the court. Because like I said, when they made the amendment in the Constitution in 1963, it was not contemplated to cover all aspects of protest if a person is doing. And that has been further strengthened by the amendments made in UAPA about unlawful activities and terrorist acts that have been included. So therefore, of course, there is nothing constitutional or not constitutional, because the NIA, the act itself empowers the central government to pick and choose and hand over the investigation at the nth hour, and that may be investigated by the NIA the moment the NIA takes over and has a special court to it. then we all know where the investigation is likely to go and what the rights of the accused person are. But the question is a good one because it's a particularly specific one as far as this lecture is concerned.
Any more questions, friends? Yeah. Any more questions? You can please.
There was one by Maruti Raj. He says,
yes, the role of the prosecutor. The role of the prosecutor.
Prosecutor in the NIA. The NIA Act itself has for the appointment of special public prosecutors under Section 15, who are appointed by the central government. And those persons are the ones who will try, who will assist in the prosecution. So now if the court is located somewhere, say in Balia in Uttar Pradesh, and the central government will then appoint the special public prosecutor or the public prosecutor to try the case as far as the NIA court is concerned. Though the offense may be of UAPA. There is another All case right. asked Mohammed, I don't know, what if 90-day extension is not followed by PP, whether there is right to bail? Yes, of course, if it is not granted the extension, then the person is entitled to bail because that is dependent on that aspect that he is granted.
Then, so there is one question from Vinodharani. She's asked that what is the impact of the 2019 amendment yeah. where you have included a terrorist? I think for that question, if you can just give an answer.
Yeah, now that question is, of course, pending adjudication in the Supreme Court. So
yes,
I don't want to second guess the outcome of that, but that is, and I know I've used this word over and over again, that it is egregious, it is particularly bad because there is no show cause notice that is given to you before you are declared as a terrorist, and being labeled as a terrorist is a grave violation of a person's individual rights that are guaranteed under the Constitution. Because then you are labeled as a terrorist, then the review committee will sit. Review committee will decide whether you are being labeled as a terrorist was correct or not. Not a committee under Section 3. There's no adjudication on it. So there, of course, it has a lot of problems. And God willing and hopefully, if it is struck down, that will be the best thing that can happen to this particular aspect. I don't know why it was introduced, but that is the government of the day. And I'm not saying anything against the government of the day. As we have seen progressively from 1967 to 2004 to 2008, 2013 and 2019, this act is being misused and various amendments are being made to it, which are only taking away a person's liberty. There is some other questions, Naveen, that you may want to.
Yes, I think we'll have the last three questions. There is one by Sai Govindraja.
Is there any other law in any country similar to that of UAPA which provides for designation? No, there isn't. There isn't, and it wasn't even there in the earlier acts which dealt with terrorism. This is a new novel amendment in 2019.
But just from my perspective, of course, I also agree with you the fact that it somewhere tramples upon the fundamental rights in a way that it narrows down too much and it strangulates us. Yeah. But considering the present-day consequence and present-day scenario yeah. where terrorism is on the rise and intelligence, even in the Mumbai blast, yeah. That was a small intelligence failure and that led to what you know very well. Yeah. So, isn't there a harmonious process where we will have to figure out how to balance the interest than calling this act a complete trampling on the human rights or fundamental rights as the case may be? Isn't this required in the present day?
That has always been the excuse that the government has used. The moment there are incidents, like it led to the passing of TADA, that there is militancy in Punjab, the present local laws are not sufficient to handle it. So we will come out with a law which violates every aspect of an accused, including confessions made to a police officer. So there is no limit to this. Tomorrow another incident takes place, they said we are suspending all laws, there is no question of bail, until you are acquitted, you will be permanently remanded into judicial custody. We suspend the right of bail. We suspend the right of all. So you can't have incidents to deal with it. You are a state. You are broad. You have resources at your powers. You don't need these petty laws to come to your aid to stifle. These are all done for their own political gains. I have yet to come across it being used in an impartial and an unfair manner. And just to give you an example, the constitutional validity of NIA was tested. By whom? By Pragya Thakur in the Mumbai High Court, and it was upheld. So in 2012, it is the other government which is facing it. In the present government, it is that government, the members of those parties, political parties, which are facing it. So it keeps going, but it doesn't matter to them. But for a common citizen to be labeled as a terrorist, can you imagine the impact it has? And why do you need it? If you're a member of a terrorist organization, you made that amendment in 2008, it already covers it. You don't have to label an individual as a terrorist person. An individual to be a terrorist, I fail to understand what an individual will do. I can understand an organization working as a terrorist, and you've declared them as terrorist organization, and a person is a member of those organizations.
Yes, sir. So there is one question from Ramamurthy. I think we can have the last two questions and wind up.
So his question is, the procedure under NIA Act with regard to initiation and conduct of investigation seems to not favor speed in investigations, especially in cases where the evidence trail may go cold in most criminal activity. Would like to know your thoughts on this, sir. Yes, of course. Because if the IO who seized of the matter and is investigating it with alacrity, then has to send that note to the state government. State government forwards it to the central government. Central government has 15 days to decide whether to take up the case or not. So even the IO at the local level is not interested. I'm not saying that criminals should be let be allowed to roam free and go free. But even then, the IO will say, look, this is an offense punishable, it's covered by NIA. Why should I bother investigating it? Whenever they will come, they will take over and they will start their investigation. So yes, Mr. Ramamurthy is right to that extent that yes, it will delay it by the time the central government, we know how decisions in central government and state governments are taken.
So I think one last question, if you can see.
Sham is an interesting. Sham is, sir, where there is an offense committed interstate.
Yes, interstate, yes.
Investigative agency like NIA. I mean, I don't know. Is it if you commit a 420 case in Chennai, and I lodge an FIR in Delhi. Delhi police is fairly competent to come all the way to Chennai and pick you up and get you and put you in Tihar jail. We don't have that US system where the police cannot transcend the borders of the state. It is all India, pan India. So the state police are perfectly competent for this is only for the control of the central government, which did not have the investigative power for themselves to investigate into these offences.
So one more question from Sai Govindaraja, where he refers to the Home Minister Mr. Amit Shah's speech, yeah. Where Mr. Amit Shah has referred to the situation in China, Pakistan, US, yeah. Where they have the power to designate individuals as terrorists.
Yes.
Any specific comments on that, sir?
Yes, and none of those countries have a constitution like ours. So if you want to become like China or Pakistan and
US,
then
US, you know it well, sir. US has a broader, I think, in terms
US
of size.
Look at what the, I don't want to get into the semantic, but if you want to become like countries which are like China or Pakistan, yes, certainly we can do away with all those well-cherished rights which the constitution makers gave us. And we can go back to having a police state, but we are not a police state. We are a state which cherishes individual liberty. We have a
But what happens when there is a conflict between fundamental rights? See, that on one hand, we are talking about the fundamental rights of these people, so alleged people. On the other hand, you have the public safety at large and the public interest at large. When there is a conflict, as you rightly say, that could possibly be an argument by the state, public interest should prevail. That can be the plausible argument. But how do we weigh both these rights? You're absolutely right. I completely agree with you. But what happens when there is a conflict?
So therefore, the restriction that was contemplated in 1963 was a narrow restriction of sovereignty and integrity of India. Now, if you suppose tomorrow you are protesting against, now just not to be touchy about this topic, but against imposition of Hindi
in Tamil Nadu, yes.
So which was exactly the reason in 67 why UAPA was brought out. DMK said we are anti the imposition of policies from the central government. And they came out with the 90s. It affects everyone at a basic level. Any protest, it is so broad, Naveen. You can cover any and every protest by economic blockade which took place between Manipur and Nagaland or whatever some years ago, where petrol couldn't reach Manipur because Nagas were blocking that. Any aspect you can cover under as a terrorist act, and you can make it punishable with this protest and have some sort of a risk of being taken under UAPA.
So Sir, I think the last question we'll take Vinodharani's question, and I think we can conclude, sir. The last question from Vinodharani.
The NIA doesn't need the permission of the state while conducting. Unlike how this is a very good question. Absolutely correct. This was the mischief that was done in NIA. See, for CBI requires consent to invest. And here they have said, see, that's why I read out the first section 6 first says transmitted by IO, SG, you will decide. Then it moves in 3 and 4, it moves Suomoto or coming to know on its own. So the mischief is in the wordings. If I can understand, if the state government doesn't transmit it, you will say, no, I don't want it. It is my consent. It is up to me whether I transmit it or not. But now they have said Suomoto coming to know on its own. So Kerala has a particular problem about some agitation taking place. The central government will say, all right, this requires an IA investigation. I'm taking over the investigation. I don't care two hoots about the state, which is in charge of law and order and under the entry in list 2.
Sir, I think there have been a lot of thanks. Mr. Ganesh Rambalingam has thanked you. Mr. Sai Govindraj has thanked you. Thank you very much, sir. So I think this is, you've certainly opened up a lot of thought process for all of us. Of course, I believe, of course, I agree with you in one part, sir, but I agree to disagree, I told you. It's just about, having conflicting rights. Because yeah. I believe that in a way that rights cannot be trampled upon. But maybe I think there is a balance that is required. I think maybe the Act has not had the foresight for a balance. Perhaps in the 2019 judgment, the challenger is pending in the Supreme Court. We might hope a judgment might iron out the differences. But thank you very much, sir. It's a topic that has definitely had to be debated upon. And the last 1.5 hours, we've always been very engaged. Thank you very much for sharing your insights. It has certainly been a very lively lecture. You can see that from the questions and the participants' response. You can see that all of us definitely go back home more richer in terms of knowledge. Thank you very much, sir. We hope to have many more lectures from your side. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I thank everyone. Thank you so much.
I thank all my friends and participants for taking time off and participating. We hope to join you on an interesting lecture sometime soon in the next few days. I'll keep all of you updated. Thank you very much, friends and seniors.